you're on.
All right, thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this Mayor and City Council work session for Tuesday, October 29th, about 1:10. Sorry for us coming out a little late. Got tied up there. Prior to this open session, we had a meeting and topic discussion with legal, real estate, and personnel matters. Persons present were Mayor Rick Meehan, City Manager David Recor, Council President Lloyd Martin, Council Secretary Mary Knight, Council Members Doug Simek, Margaret Pillis, Brent Ashley, Dennis Dare, and Joe Matresik. And we were also joined by City Solicitor Guy Ayers, OC Director Glenn Irwin, OCDC Vice President Jane Ayer, and Executive Officer Associate Diane Chavis was there. There's a motion made by Councilman Matresik and a second by Councilman Pillis to adjourn the meeting. Motion was unanimous. Okay. Next is we have the comments from the public. If any person who may wish to speak on any matter scheduled for discussion on the work session agenda may be heard during comments from the public for a period of 3 minutes or such time as may be deemed appropriate by the Council President. Anyone wishing to be heard shall state their name and address and agenda item on which he or she wishes to speak. Okay, anyone in the audience? Yes, sir. Welcome.
Harry Parkowitz, Cambridge Section, Ocean City. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
New business on E. What is that changing of the council meeting schedule? What did that pertain?
That's the schedule where we have our meetings. We actually try to approve them as we move forward for the next year so we can put them on a website. That's our dates for our work sessions and our regular session meetings, because some days there's holidays, like Columbus Day, whatever else, we're moving our date.
I understand that. Okay. I mean, if there's no change unless there's a holiday and there's a meeting on a Monday, it'll be on a Tuesday.
Exactly. And some of them we actually don't have meetings during the Maryland Municipal League in June.
Herbie, it's a schedule like this.
Yes.
Where we see whole year in advance where we
are. All right. Thank you.
Yep. Okay. All right. Anyone else in the public? Okay. Seeing none. Moving on. Okay. Next is new business. We'll do the bid openings. Council Secretary Knight. City Manager. Yeah. First one will be for medical supplies.
Hey. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm asking that they be remanded to staff for further review and be awarded at a later date.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Correct.
Okay. The first one is from Bond Tree Medical from Dublin, Ohio. The next one is Ever Ready from Brooklyn, New York. This one is from Henry Shine EMS from Irmo, South Carolina. Ladrill Medical Corporation out of Wappingers Falls, New York. McKesson Medical Surgical Inc. Medical and Veterinarian Supplies out of Mattawa, Illinois. MMS, which is Midwest Medical Supply out of Daytona, Florida. Quad Med Inc. out of Jacksonville, Florida. Southeastern Emergency Equipment out of Youngsville, North Carolina. And those are all of them.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Matresik.
Motion to acknowledge receipt of the 9 medical supply bids and remand the staff for final approval.
Okay. Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Ashley. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. Thank you. That's a lot to do there. Okay. Next, we have a bid opening for roof replacement and restoration project. Dean, welcome.
Good afternoon. There is a bid bond required, and we do need to read prices A and B into the record.
The first bid is from Control Roofing and Sheep Metal Corporation from Linthicum, Maryland. There is a bid bond. Okay, what it looks like, they only bid on number A, $918,200. And on item B, item two, they're calling no bid. We're just making sure. Okay, we're correct.
Okay. Basically, some people, I just found out before I came in here, added the cost of the roofing that we've already purchased. We furnished that information to the bidders so that they knew what we were furnishing. So obviously, this contractor has added the cost of the roofing.
Right, okay.
Okay. We have one other bid.
Prior to me coming here, I did know of four bidders. Obviously, they didn't heed my advice to send their bid early, so most likely they'll show up tomorrow, FedEx.
Is there a bid bond? Yeah. This is from Tecta America out of Fruitland, Maryland. There is a bid bond on number one, $585,000. On item number two or B, $99,000. And that's all the bids we have, Mr. President.
All right, thank you very much. All right. Council? It's very quiet over here.
Yes, I'd like to rebid this.
Yeah. All right. Councilmember Matresic.
I make a motion to rebid the roof.
All right, we got a motion by Councilmember Matresic. Councilmember Ashley.
Agree, second.
I got a second by Councilmember Ashley. Discussion. Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Dean, just question. Why would you have to notify the bidders to get the bid in early? Wouldn't they understand when
there's a lot of times that FedEx and UPS do not show up until after 11 o'clock. Don't know why. And it's caused a lot of people to lose a job when they were probably low. So we always notify them to try to get their price here a day early or their bid here a day early so that they know for sure that they'll be here on time. And I try to warn all the bidders that when we have our pre-bid conference.
Well, is that something where we should require the bid to be in the day before?
Well, unfortunately, when we do that, the local people, it gives them a little bit more time to adjust their price, and they hand deliver their bid. Those from the Washington-Baltimore area don't have that luxury. So
well, my point was, if they were all required to be in by 12 o'clock on Monday.
That's a possibility, yeah.
Maybe talk to the city manager, but if this is becoming an issue or you've seen this happen on many occasions.
Right.
Maybe we need to do something to make sure that it's here and will be here when we open them, number one, and then make sure it's fair for everybody by everybody requiring to have that date.
That's not uncommon. Delaware used to do that for years.
So. It would have to be 5 p.m. We often don't get delivery till late afternoon.
5 p.m. on Monday.
Monday.
But I don't know. I know we've talked about this before, but David, maybe if with the council president agrees, the council agrees, take a look at that.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Dean, thank you. I got a motion to rebid roof replacement and restoration. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Dean, thank you.
Thank you.
Take it out to bid. Thank you. All right. Next on the agenda, little spin on this. That's retirement recognition for Bill Bratton, Public Works Construction Manager. Mr. Mayor.
I'm sure. Thank you, Mr. President. I'm going to ask Director of Public Works Hal Acton to come up, please. And also like to ask Mr. Bratton to come up as well.
Yep. I think I saw him on one of his last projects already.
Billy, hang tight for a second. I'm not going to roast you or anything, but there's many people in this room that may have no idea who you are because of the job you hold. So I want to be brief and make a couple comments. I will direct my attention to the mayor and council because I don't know what level of interaction you would have with Billy at any given time. But Billy started with the town of Ocean City back in February 1984. I started a few months later in May of 84, and he is now concluding a great 30-year career. At that time in history, back in 84, the Public Works Department was run by a gentleman by the name of Chuck Vane. and they were assembling, let's call it a storm drain crew, in an effort to pipe most of the town. At that time, Dennis was city engineer, and you should remember all the details to that. Well, there's only a few sole survivors of the original group that Chuck Vane had assembled. He assembled them, in my terms, by stealing them from local utility companies such as White's Construction and Trenching by Bud. Billy's one of a handful are left, and I do want to take a moment to state that two of the guys that have been here a long time with him are sitting in the back row. Robert Birch, hand please, and Mike Miles, who came on board 1 week later. But otherwise, that crew's just about disappearing on me. Billy is one of the finest examples of someone on your staff that started out at the bottom and worked his way up. Whether it was, you know, working a shovel, a backhoe, managing a crew, eventually working his way into job titles such as maintenance worker 3, heavy equipment operator, that he then became assistant superintendent of the division, and then if I recall in 2009, he became manager of the division. He has been with me through thick and thin. He is an example of someone who was here in Hurricane Gloria, the Halloween storm of 91, the January storm of 91 also, if I recall, back-to-back, Superstorm Sandy, multiple snow events. You're looking at a guy that works 24, 36, 72 hours straight, if that's what it takes. But more importantly, the thing I like about Billy and an employee like Billy is if you go back through his personnel file, you will find no records whatsoever of negativity. You will find no sick leave abuse. You will find no inadequate performance evaluations. It's just the opposite. He's one of the select few that I can say upon his retirement, I don't remember any bad issues. So before I turn it over to the mayor, on behalf of 30 years of service, I offer you three words, one word per 10 years. Thank you, sir.
Well, Mr. Bratton, it's great to be able to stand here with you today, and I do remember and came along shortly after 1984 and do know the contributions you've made and the fact that so many members of your department are here today to show their appreciation for what you've done for them and for our town and respect for you, I think is great. So thank you all for being here today. I think that's terrific. Also, Hal didn't say it, but I'd like to thank you for doing the best you could over the last 30 years to make Hal look good. Maybe you don't know, but we all know he wasn't doing it all by himself. So, but Hal's been up here, and he always refers to the people that work in his departments, and we've always heard him mention your name very often. So it's an honor to be standing here with you. And I do have a proclamation I'd like to read. And this is from the Mayor and Council and all the citizens of Ocean City when it says, Proclamation and Appreciation of Bill F. Bratton, 30 years of service. Then it says Bill W. Which one is it?
Billy.
Okay. I might have to change that. Okay. Bill Bratton has contributed 30 years of dedicated service to the town of Ocean City, where he began his career in 1983. And whereas Bill Bratton has played an integral role in the Public Works Department of the town of Ocean City for 30 years, and whereas Bill Bratton's skill and experience have been instrumental in the overall success of the Public Works Department for the town of Ocean City, Maryland. Now, therefore, I, Rick Meehan, Mayor of the town of Ocean City, along with the Ocean City Council, do hereby commend Bill for his 30 years of devoted service and wish him a happy and healthy retirement. Mr. Bratton. And I have another presentation, and I noticed your family's here. Would you like them to come up here with you and get in the picture for this one? Come on up. Yes, yes. Would you like to introduce who's here with you today?
This is my wife, Linda. This is my daughter-in-law, Becky. And this is my son, Jason.
Well, it's nice to have you all here with us today. You should be very proud, which I know you are, of Bill and his contributions. And I know you're looking forward to seeing him enjoy his retirement from the town of Ocean City. But before you leave, I do want to present you with this. And this is the key to the city. And this is from the mayor and city council, our city manager, everybody in this room, and all the citizens of Ocean City, to thank you for 30 years of service with the Public Works Department of the town of Ocean City, Maryland. Congratulations, Bill. Why don't you hold that up? And all of you come on in and get pictures. Thank you all very much. Mr. Bryant, would you like to say a few words?
First of all, I'd like to thank the mayor and city council to recognize me and all the other employees that work for the town. One memorable moment in my career, and didn't happen too long after I started, just a few months, was Hurricane Gloria. Me and a co-worker were riding down the boardwalk about 3 o'clock in the morning. Let me back up just a little bit. They were evacuating the town. I'd only been here just a few months. Worked for private sector all my life in construction. And we were coming in town, but they weren't letting anybody else in town but us. We had to show our ID, Route 90 Bridge. Everybody else was going out. I thought something was wrong with this picture. So after we got in here, all we could do, just stage, they staged us in the areas, weak points of town. One place they staged myself and a police officer with a dump truck at Route 50 Bridge. If it started flooding out, we were all going to get off. But what I was saying, me and a coworker were riding the boardwalk about 3 o'clock in the morning. Gloria came through, daylight broke, and when we headed back to the shop that following morning, the sun was shining, all that stuff, I could not believe my eyes. There was no boardwalk at all left. It was strewed from against the buildings of the houses and buildings on the boardwalk all the way across Coastal Highway. We had to zigzag back to 65th Street for boards, nails, and chunks of boardwalk. So that was one of the fascinating times in my career here, and that's one of the books I'm going to be writing, chapters I'm going to be telling. Appreciate this. I've talked to Dennis about this, and he's okay if I get free parking from now on. He said, all I've got to do is put it in my dash.
Thank
you all.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Bill, again. All right, next on the agenda is new business, a discussion of changes to Springfest vendor closing times and fee structure presented by Special Events Manager. Frank, all yours.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ever since I started in this position with the town, which is actually 7 months as of tomorrow.
Goes fast.
There's been a lot of discussion among us within the special events staff about the idea of trying to help our vendors out and allow them to close a little bit earlier on Springfest and Sunfest. We decided at Sunfest this year to put it out to the vendors to get their feedback. We always had some people that would provide feedback in our surveys. We asked them in our pre-event meeting to provide feedback specifically on this, and over 80% came back and said that this is something that they wanted to do. One of our concerns has always been, and it's been something that was thrown around over the years, one of our concerns has always been is how do we shut down the vendors and still have patrons coming in for the entertainment tent and the entertainment that takes place there, the concerts. So what we came up with, which was actually an idea of the vendors, was to do a small rate increase for Springfest. We're going to do this as a trial to see if it works, of $5. That will allow us to cover the cost of bringing in some extra security. That security would be used to watch over the tents and the midway area while the entertainment tent is still running live with a concert. Basically, what we're trying to do is shut the arts and crafts tents and the food tent down at 8 p.m. at Springfest 2014 on the evenings of the concerts, which is Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights. This would require us to have security for up to 3 hours, starting around 7:30 and finishing as late as 10:30. At that point, the Ocean City Police Department would take over their normal operations of overseeing the entire venue. And what we're looking for this today is for your blessing to make those changes to the hours, as well as do the $5 rate increase across the board.
Okay. Councilmember Matresi.
Well, I was just a comment. The Recreation and Parks Commission did listen to this and also approved of it, so.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
I was going to make a motion to approve the request to stop or to allow the vendors to go home at 8 p.m. and for the additional $5 charge.
Okay. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll second with just a question.
Motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Ashley. Go ahead with your question.
Frank, can you tell me, you say here that the staff would be acquired through the beach patrol for the extra security?
Yes. Instead of utilizing the Ocean City Police Department, which would be a little more taxing on the police department and more costly for us as a town, what we do for the entertainment venue, for the entertainment tent during concerts, is we bring in beach patrol members and we hire them at a much lower rate to provide security for the concerts. We would look to do the same type of thing for the tents for those 3 hours as well as the midway.
Is there enough of them here at that time to do that? I mean,
when we talked to Ward, he felt that we could still make that happen. Okay. And if not, then we could look outside of beach patrol.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Discussion. Mr. Mayor.
Frank, you said you did a survey and 80% agreed.
Yes, correct.
How strong was the feeling of the other 20%? Because they're going to be the ones that come in here next.
Yeah. there was no one that said that they wanted to stay open until 10 p.m.
Right.
Those people, the 80% of the ones that specifically stated they wanted to close early, there were some that said 9 o'clock. There were some that said as early as 6 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
But the ones that said 8 o'clock, that's the 80%. About 83%, actually.
Okay. I've always been a little concerned about that. I'm a believer in the mall concept and having been a retailer. And, you know, once one person starts to close, everybody decides it's over.
Right.
And so you're going to make it basically in the tents mandatory that they close?
It'll be mandatory in the arts and crafts tent as well as the food tent that they close. The vendors in the median, in the midway that are outside of the entertainment pavilion, they'll have the option to close. They may close as early as 8 o'clock. They may choose to stay open because of the patrons that are there for the concert.
Okay. So we're going to try this at SpringFest, and you'll come back to us, and if there's any changes that need to be made or recommendations, you'd let us know at that time?
Absolutely.
Okay.
All right. Councilmember Pillis.
Will the patrons who have to close in the tents, will they have an optional maybe next year to be able to be out in the midway so they would be able to stay open? I mean, is that from year to year that's assigned to the same group?
The tents in the midway are actually categorized differently. Yep. The arts and crafts tents are strictly arts and crafts vendors who provide product that is 80% or more handmade by them. The vendors who are out in the midway are mostly commercial vendors or buy-sell vendors who purchase things and then resell them. Mm-hmm. So different categories.
Okay. And the $5, did the 20%, any in that 20% did not want to pay that $5 because they're going to have to pay the $5 now?
No, there were actually...
Everybody was okay.
Yeah, there were no comments that basically said we're against this or we don't believe in closing early.
Okay.
Okay.
Just people who didn't declare one way or another.
Thank you. Councilmember Matresi.
I believe the 80% was to close at 8 p.m., and there was the other 20% was scattered on closing at different times, correct?
Yes.
It wasn't necessarily to stay there the whole time. It was just to close some earlier, some later.
Correct. Or they didn't comment on that particular.
Or they didn't comment on that at all. You know, it's when somebody comes in and takes something over and looks at it with fresh eyes and listens to what is going on out there, they come with these types of ideas, and I think that this is probably one overdue. Most of the vendors that if you talk to are the only regret they have is they don't get to enjoy Ocean City at all, to go out to dinner, to go out to a bar or something like that because they're tied up there at the tent so long. So I think this is the right thing to do, and I think that it's going to be a big success.
Thank you.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Ashley to change the vendor closure time and the vendor rates. All those in favor? Motion's unanimous. Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor.
Frank, I know this goes without saying, but you're going to make sure that this is publicized and that there are signs on the tents, you know, stating what time they'll be open and closed, because a lot of people over the years, you know, they might not have gone in there until after 8 o'clock before, but as soon as you tell them it's going to be closed at 8 o'clock, they're all going to want to go in there at 8 o'clock.
Right.
So you better let them know in advance.
Very good. Will do.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Frank.
Thank you,
John. All right. We'll see how it works out. Next on the council agenda is new business request approval for Ocean City Police Department general orders presented by Captain Guyton. Greg, welcome.
Good afternoon. How's everyone doing?
Good.
Let me walk you through the orders. Mr. Martin, I'm going to use you as the guide as where you think I've said enough as we go through these.
The summary is very good if you want to go over the summary.
All right. Well, I'll start with that. The very first one is dealing with Department of Direction and Organization. And in 2012, when the agency went to the three-captain concept as opposed to the four-captain concept, there was a revision in duties and responsibilities. And that was in place up until when Chief Bizzurro took over in July. He looked over the organizational structure, and he decided he wanted to make some changes in how areas of responsibility were divvied out between the divisions and also within his office of the chief. The one thing that he found to be very important that he wanted to maintain exclusive control without having division commander involved was dealing with public affairs, which would be the PIO position, and also community services dealing with neighborhood watch, emergency preparedness, special events. Those things are kind of near and dear to him, and he wanted to keep exclusive control without having a division commander overseeing it. So, and then there was areas that he wanted to have extra review on. So the Office of Professional Standards was moved under Support Services, and which gave one more tier of review in regards to policy, research and development, dealing with internal affairs. And he also, as you know, that because this body gave the approval for him, is the Selective Enforcement Unit, which was a new unit created utilizing patrol officers, moving them to the Criminal Investigation Division, and then using them for special purposes on select issues that pop up from now and again. He also moved crime analysis under that same division of CID. So now it's using intelligence-based information through crime analysis with this unit, along with the other detectives working in concert with the patrol division. So that's the nuts and bolts of that change. Again, it's more of a housekeeping change on the department direction and organization, and you should have a new sure. spreadsheet showing the outline of the agency in that.
All right. Councilmember Matresi.
Motion to approve General Order 100A-1.
I got a motion by Councilmember Matresi. Councilmember Knight.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Knight to approve GO 100A-1. All those in favor? Vote unanimous. Okay.
Okay, the next one, it's General Order 100D2.
Don't you have General to ask orders
require the approval of the mayor.
Yes, I approve.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
I apologize. Cut you out of all this.
No, that's all right. I knew you'd come back. I knew Guy would jump in.
Okay, the next one is General Order 100D2, employee recognition. This was an order that was been in place since 1999 called the Accommodation Board. And through the collective bargaining and with the Joint Labor Management Committee, we started talking about recognition in general. And one of the things that was lacking was dealing with retirees. When we first started having several retirements coming up, we had the burden of individual recognitions through retirement parties and things of that nature. And about 3 years ago, we decided to use the one-year event of the Neighborhood Watch Officer of the Year event. And I think a lot of you attended, and I think you've seen a big change in that in the last 2 or 3 years. And we thought that's a great opportunity to bring about not only the Officer of the Year, any type of promotions that have happened within the year, any type of employee retirement recognition, and also any accommodations that come about. It's a great venue to do it. I've gone the last 2 years. There are a lot in attendance, and it's a real good feeling at that time. So what we've done is we've taken that accommodation board policy and changed it to employee recognition to include all of these type of celebratory type of recognitions for employees and retirees. And that outlines the changes in that particular policy.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve General Order 100D-2.
All right. Got a motion by Councilmember Knight. Mr. Councilmember Tressi.
Second.
I have a second by Councilmember Tressi. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Mr. Mayor, you
yes,
approve?
I do approve.
Yep. I won't forget you this twice.
Okay, the third policy is General Order 200H2. It's called bias-based profiling. There is only two changes. One is a related directive notification of a standard operating procedure, ADM-007, which discusses our tracking of race-based data, which is required by the state. When this came about 11 years ago, each agency was left with developing their own policy and procedure and the cost associated with tracking this information. Since then, the state has funded a program by Delta Plus, which is part of ETICS. Several of our enforcement actions are now done through a computerized called ETICS in our vehicles. What they have done is they've associated this data collection as part of that unit fully funded by the state. Now, we pay for the equipment, don't get me wrong there, but the actual software program is completely funded by the state. So we developed a standard operating procedure to address that, which is now included in this policy. And the only other change is there was a reference at one time called a traffic stop data sheet, and we changed it to traffic stop data form. And other than that, that policy is unchanged from its original publication date.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve General Order 200H-2.
All right. Councilmember Pillows.
I'll second it.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Pillows. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Do you concur, Mr. Mayor?
Yes, I do concur.
All right.
Okay, the next general order I have is 200U1, use of force. There are three changes. Again, this is all for housekeeping purposes. The one change deals because of a terminology change that Taser International has put in place. And we spoke to them in regards to, and I'm probably going to mess it up because I'm so used to saying ECD all the time for the electronic control device. That was the term utilized for the equipment that we bought. Taser is the manufacturer name, but it's an electronic control device. They have now changed that to a conductive electrical weapon, a CEW. Weapon. And in talking to them, it was important that we kept our terminology the same for purposes of litigation purposes in the future. Hopefully you never go down that path. But we wanted to be able to be talking the same terminology should we ever need Taser to assist us that show that our policy was consistent. That was the first change that comes about in this use of force policy. The second is the inclusion of another less lethal weapon called the less lethal launcher. This is a weapon that we've had for about 10 years. We've developed a standard operating procedure, and we wanted to make sure that it fell within our guidelines on a use of force as an impact weapon. And this is a weapon that, through gas pressure, launches a projectile that is used for less lethal situations, and it's used to direct an impact to, like, the fleshy area in the leg or whatnot, similar to a baton strike, except that you can be a distance away from the individual as opposed to having to be so that one-on-one contact. So that was included in this policy. And then the final one, back to the CEW, want to get the terminology right again, there was a court case in Maryland. It was the Reed case, which talked about a fleeing suspect and the use of a taser, and that they determined in that case that if you use it on a fleeing suspect, that it would need probable cause. Well, that means there needs to be probable cause for arrest. So we wanted to make sure that that was outlined in the use of force policy. It's something we've been teaching all along since we've had the weapon in place. And unfortunately, the way that our use of force policy talks about terminology, we also use active aggression and active resistance, both which would indicate an arrest was going to be made, so which also indicate probable cause. So legally, this is very sound by making that reference to that particular case.
All right. Councilmember Simon.
Motion to approve General Order 200U1.
All right. Councilmember Pillows.
I have a question, and I'll second it with a question.
All right. I have a motion and a second.
I've not seen any order or anybody come and ask for the gas projector weapon. Do we own those things?
Yes.
We do?
We've had them.
Seen it work.
Solidly 8 years. It may even be longer than that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I missed it.
Yeah, I'm.
We missed it.
Yeah, we weren't here then when you bought them. But they last forever? Is that what happened?
When I say 8 years, I think it's longer than that, but yeah, I'm very confident it's been.
Yeah,
at least
I'll
8 years.
My second in place then. Yeah.
Okay. All right. All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Simic and a second by Councilmember Pillis to approve General Order 200U1. All those in favor? Motion is unanimous. Mr. Mayor?
Yes, I do approve.
All right. Go ahead.
The next one I have on my list is General Order 600J1, Juvenile Custody and Care. Out of all of the policies, this is the one that needed the most attention. This policy had been in place since 1990 with limited updates through Chief of Police memorandums. So we're going through this. We started doing some research with CALEA, IACP, and this is the policy I believe is only 2 pages long, and now I believe it's something like 8 pages long. And actually 13, 14 pages long. It lays out things that we've been practicing for years, but we just never got around to get them in writing, and now we have them in writing. From how we deal with a juvenile and laying out information that, you know, juveniles, when they commit delinquent acts, are not really treated as adults. In court, they're never found guilty. They're found involved. They use different terminology such as that. And also, we wanted to lay out guidelines dealing with truancy and runaway. There's a section that talks about the crimes that offenses that are being committed by a juvenile, in which you have to notify the local school district about the offense that happened and who was involved. And then there's also crimes that are committed by some juveniles, which would be somebody under the age of 18. When they're 16 and 14, they are automatically processed like an adult, and they are held to the same standards as an adult, even though they might be 14 or 16 years of age. And then at the very end of the policy is a guideline that walks officers through should they ever have a question on, do I actually make a physical arrest here? Do I issue a citation? Do I make a referral to juvenile services? So we utilized a lot of the information coming from the Department of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency, along with the Maryland Juvenile Services and Social Services, in compiling this information. But this was the policy that absolutely needed the most work out of the group that I have.
Okay. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve General Order 600J-1.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Simak. Discussion? Councilmember Pills?
Yes. Do the most of the other jurisdictions, do they follow this policy?
Go ahead and finish.
The changes?
Yes, because they're regulated by federal law and state law.
Okay, thank you.
And a lot of them are very, because it's federal law, state to state, they're very, very consistent in how they look at a juvenile offender.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Any other discussion? Okay. I have a motion and a second for General Order 600J1. All those in favor? Motion is unanimous. Mr. Mayor, do you confirm?
Yes, I do approve, and it is amazing how much the world has changed since 1990.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to wonder where we were on letting this one go so far. But.
All right.
The next one is General Order 800I2. I think you'll see some maybe some approvals by Guy. There was some misinterpretation. It might have said I-1, but it's I-2, and I have an email where Guy and I have gotten back together with one another to get that clarified. He has reviewed all of these general orders, but this one, I think there was a little bit of confusion. This was a cell phone policy. Now, the town has its own cell phone policy that regulates cell phone usage, owned cell phones particularly, and when you should and shouldn't use them. We changed the title list to mobile wireless communication device use because everyone knows that a cell phone doesn't look like a cell phone anymore. It looks like a little computer, and a matter of fact, acts like a small computer. And we wanted to incorporate all of these handheld smartphones, communication devices. And what we relied on was the town's current policy. We also looked at state law, and you notice that there's been a big push in enforcement actions on distracted driving. And there's actually a provision within the transportation article that allows law enforcement to use a cell phone for duty-related purposes. We as an agency felt that we didn't want to go down that road, that we wanted to be more restrictive. And our restriction is that in cases of emergencies, an officer can use that cell phone without a hands-free device for the purpose of that immediate emergency. And once that emergency is over, they either go to a hands-free or they use some other type of forms of communication. But we didn't want to allow it to this all-encompassing law enforcement use or duty use, but we wanted to try to stay in line with the city's policy, which forbids it completely. This has been given to Eric Langstrom. He reviewed this as a policy moving forward for the police department. He indicated that he had no reservations, and he was here earlier, no reservations with the policy as it's written. We also talk about personal use of cell phones. A lot of individuals, they don't even have phones in their homes anymore. The cell phone is their sole purpose of communication, and we wanted to actually regulate how they carry it, when they use it, what's acceptable for use on duty. Even now, because of phones being able to take pictures, we wanted to be able to have some ownership when they're working and they take a photograph of a scene, which may have great value to us as an investigative tool. We wanted to be able to have ownership, not of the device, but of at least the image or the video that they took, to be able to regulate that we can get that and only that alone. So that's where that particular policy is coming from.
All right. Councilmember Simak.
A motion to approve General Order 800-I-2 related to mobile wireless communication device use.
Okay, Councilmember Ashley.
Second with a comment.
All right. I got a motion and a second. Go ahead with your comment.
Well, I think this is good, Captain. I had brought up the last meeting that Anne Arundel County had a similar type directive from their chief. And, in fact, I pulled out what he said, and I think this is very important to the change here. He said, police must model the driving behaviors we expect from our motorists. The current cell phone law has exempted law enforcement, but public opinion has clearly not. So I think this is... And I also noticed in my research that a lot of other agencies have similar.
Is that Kevin Davis?
It is Kevin Davis, yes.
Kevin Davis, and this kind of goes hand in hand with an initiative that the agency is taking on beginning of November 1st. Kevin Davis has been a huge proponent when he was in Prince George's County about a program called Arrive Alive. And it's because of several tragedies with their officers due to distracted driving. If you've not sat in a police vehicle in recent years, there are more distractions in that vehicle than there ever was in 1984 when I first started, between computers used to communicate with the officers to go to calls, to in-car cameras, you name it, there's just a lot of distractions in there. Kevin is a huge proponent of safety for officers and eliminating distracted driving, and it does not surprise me at all that he would come out with a statement such as that.
Well, he also said the police chief identified distracted driving as a, quote, health and wellness issue that our society is just now beginning to effectively address. So.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Ashley to approve GO 800-I-2, mobile wireless communication device. All those in favor? Motion is unanimous. Mr. Mayor, do you concur?
Yes, I concur.
All right. One more.
Last, and as the mayor indicated, how the world has changed since 1990, this order was actually in 1988. It was put out dealing with AIDS, and at that time in all of our lives, AIDS was a topic of discussion, and precautionary measures were being conducted through public safety and just the public in general. And what we've found over the last several years is it's more than just AIDS. It's just dealing with bloodborne pathogens, with the hepatitis viruses and things of that nature. So what we have done is working with EMS, Chris Schaefer, and with Chuck Barton, we have come up with a standard operating procedure that is outlined dealing with communicable disease prevention that talks about all type of bloodborne pathogens and preventive measures that an agency should do for their employees, whether an encounter with an individual, with encounters with clothing items after an individual that may be exposed. And through the help of, again, EMS, we've come up with a standard operating procedure. What we would like is this general order dealing exclusively just with AIDS be rescinded, and then we'll adopt the standard operating procedure, which is more up to date. It has an exposure plan that's been approved by EMS. It's what we teach now in our first line academies. in dealing with things on exposure to hepatitis or a pathogen type diseases.
All right, Councilmember Simak.
I would make a motion to rescind General Order Number 400A1 related to AIDS.
All right, Councilmember Knight.
Second.
All right, I got a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Knight to rescind 400A1. Discussion, Councilmember Ashley.
No.
Nope. Okay. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Mr. Mayor, do you concur?
Yes.
All right. Motion carried, and good job.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm sure there'll be more coming. All right. Next on the agenda is request to approve revised 2014 Marin Council work session meeting schedule. Excuse me. David.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mayor, council members, we scheduled this agenda item as follow-up to our initial discussion on this matter. There are actually four changes. We actually removed the June 10th work session. That is the week of the MML conference. We did so in order to encourage more participation in the MML conference that week from our department heads and staff, as we previously discussed. We added a June 24th work session. There was discussion about adding a July 1st work session at the last time we discussed the calendar. I don't think any of us realized that would have ended up in back-to-back work sessions, so we removed that July 1st work session, and then we added a November 12th work session following that holiday, and those are the four changes on this calendar.
Okay. Councilmember Tressick.
Motion to approve the 2014 council meeting schedule.
All right. Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
All right. I've got a motion by Councilmember Tressick and a second by Councilmember Ashley. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you.
While I have the floor, I just wanted to make sure that everyone noticed and the file that was attached to the Friday facts. The status update, Councilmember Dare was kind enough to send some activities and projects had requested a status update on them, and I wanted to make sure everybody caught that file attachment.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yep. Okay. Right. Good enough.
All right. Councilmember Tressick.
Motion to retire to closed session for previously stated reasons.
All right. Councilmember Pillis.
I'll second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Tressick and a second by Councilmember Pillis to retire to closed session. All those in favor? Thank you. All right. We'll be back in a little while, guys. Thank you. Go ahead.